morning. My name is Father Josh McCarty. I'm the parochial vicar here at Blessed Mother Parish. Today we celebrate the feast of St. Peter and St. Paul. St. Peter, upon whom the church is built, and St. Paul, whose conversion and passion and witness for the church inspires us all. Let us begin our prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. On this great celebration of Saints Peter and Paul, we celebrate those two saints who, by their proclamation of the gospel, made known to the world the glory of the risen Lord. Brothers and sisters, that we may more worthily celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins and ask God for pardon. I confess. In my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault, therefore, may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, O Lord our God, that we may be sustained by the intercession of the blessed apostles Peter and Paul, that as through them you gave your church the foundations of her heavenly office, so through them you may help her to eternal salvation. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In those days, King Herod laid hands upon some members of the church to harm them. He had James, the brother of John, killed by the sword. And when he saw that he was pleasing to the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. It was the feast of the unleavened bread. He had him taken into custody and put in prison under the guard of four squads of four soldiers each. He intended to bring him before the people after Passover. Peter was thus being kept in prison, but prayer by the church was fervently being made to God on his behalf. On the very night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter, secured by double chains, was sleeping between two soldiers, while outside the door, guards kept watch on the prison. Suddenly, the angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the cell. He tapped Peter on the side and awakened him, saying, "Get up quickly." The chains fell from his wrists. The angel said to him, "Put on your belt and your sandals." He did so. Then he said to him, "Put on your cloak and follow me." So he followed him out, not realizing that what was happening through the angel was real. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed the first guard, then the second, and came to the iron gate leading out to the city, which opened for them by itself. They emerged and made their way down an alley, and suddenly the angel left him. The word of the Lord.
Together extol his name. I saw crushed with shame. When the poor one called out, the Lord heard, and from all his distress he saved him. The angel of the Lord will rescue those who fear him. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Taste and see how good the Lord is. Blessed the man who takes refuge in him. The angel of the Lord will rescue those who fear him.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. I, Paul, am ready, already being poured out like a libation, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have competed well, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness awaits me, which the Lord, the just judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. The Lord stood by me and gave me strength so that through me the proclamation might be completed and all the Gentiles might hear it. And I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil threat and will bring me safe to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus went into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say that the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah. Still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter said in reply, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus said to him in reply, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my heavenly Father. And so I say to you, you are Peter, And upon this rock I will build my church. And the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. The gospel of the Lord. You may remember that last week I preached from down there. So I want to take a vote and see what you prefer. Being that it is the feast of Saints Peter and Paul, those who, the early ones who proclaimed the gospel, how many of you prefer it if the priest were to stand down there? Raise your hand. Down there. Down here. Yes, the lighting is bad down here, I hear. Okay. All right. And how many of you would prefer or be able to see better or whatever if I were to stand up here? Wow, a strong majority. Well, there you have it. I'll stand up here. So we have tonight, today, the Feast of Saints Peter and Saint Paul. We have strong readings as we hear about the imprisonment of Peter. And Paul, who also spent his time in prison, the chains and the swords and the gates and all the challenges that he faced because of preaching the gospel, You see, for the early apostles and saints, the cost was high. The expenses were great. Because the Roman government and many of the governments throughout the world were not very fond of this preaching of this other king. The preaching of the other king. It made them a little bit nervous, you know. Thought that their power might be in jeopardy because of it. But it didn't matter. They didn't care. Peter and Paul, the other apostles, the early disciples, they went out boldly proclaiming about this man who died and didn't stay in the tomb. They boldly proclaimed the message of the gospel. And so too in our own day, as Catholics, many of us here are Catholics, probably not everyone, but just about everybody, we find likewise strong resistance, even sometimes in our own hearts, strong resistance to many of the teachings of the church, which, Lord have mercy, we've held for 2,000 years, just about, especially the church's moral teachings, teachings of the dignity of life, teachings about sexual morality. These teachings we find stiff oppositions to at our work, at school. And it's really, it's really experiential, this opposition that we find even today. You know, celebrating St. Peter, it's such a beautiful reading that we hear from Matthew chapter 16 of Jesus saying, "You are rock, and upon this rock I will build my church." I hope that you have someday, that you have a chance to go to Rome and to go into the excavation tours, and to go underneath of St. Peter's Basilica, this beautiful basilica, this beautiful church, pointing to all corners of the world, that signifies the great unity of the 1.2 billion Catholics that are our brothers and sisters throughout the world. And if you go down into the excavation, called in Italian the scavi, you will find that underneath the great altar, Bernini's great altar in Baldacchino of St. Peter's Basilica, that literally the bones of St. Peter live there, found inside a tomb that said, "Here is Peter. Here is Peter." And so literally the church of St. Peter's is built upon St. Peter himself. You know, it's a miracle that the church has lived for this long, for 2,000 years. I mean, our Lord promises that it's going to be okay, right? He promises that it's going to be okay, but for all of the crazy popes that we've had, which you may have studied in your history class, for all the messed up priests, for all the schisms and break-aparts and problems and issues and things that continue, it's amazing that the Catholic Church is still alive and thriving, even in countries of great persecution. And so let our hearts be strengthened by the great example of the stability of the church, built on the rock of Peter, a human being, Christ, who is the head and builds his church and guards and protects it, that we too may have that same confidence and fervor as did Saints Peter and Paul, to hold fast to the true teachings, not teachings that come in and go away, but to the teachings that truly endure. And that we too, in our own lives, in our own ways, may be witnesses to the gospel, as were these two great early saints, Saint Peter and Saint Paul. Saint Paul writes in his letter to Timothy, "I've competed well, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith." As we continue to draw near to the Lord over the course of our lives, we experience different struggles and challenges. And the invitation of the Christian life is that we would engage in those struggles and that we would respond to the challenges by continually pouring out and striving for what is good, and to be generous and to be kind and to love our neighbor and to love God. Saint Paul's example to us is an example of a complete pouring out of himself. He took all of his gifts that God gave him and he gave them back. Now, given our state in life, we have different challenges and we have different gifts. But the invitation is always to use our gifts and to return them to the Lord. And so for you, I would invite you all to continue to pray for those who are not able to get out of their homes easily, for those with medical and physical challenges, and to pray, to use your gifts to pray for those in need. Because the Lord has given all of us many gifts. Those gifts change in our lives, but he continually invites us to seek the good of our neighbor and offer our gifts back to him, those that he first gave us. That's the word that I wanted to share with you all today for those who cannot be with us here around this altar. And we pray that God blesses you and all your family. Emboldened by the word of God, we profess our faith. I believe holding fast to the rock of Peter, with Christ as our head, we present to him with faith these our petitions.
For those called to lead the faithful of our church, that they may always be led by the Holy Spirit, we pray to the Lord. For people in all parts of the world, that all may see God's creation as gift and strive to be good stewards of all we have been given, we pray to the Lord. For those who suffer due to lack of basic human needs, that they may be ministered to by others with kind and generous hearts, we pray to the Lord. For the unborn and all whose lives are at risk of being taken at the hands of another, may the dignity and sanctity of their lives be upheld, we pray to the Lord. For all married couples, that they may be strengthened and renewed in their vocation to love one another and to raise strong Catholic families, we pray to the Lord. For John Martin Clark, Father Mike's father, as he undergoes and recovers from heart surgery, may the Lord grant him healing and peace, we pray to the Lord. For the members of our parish family, may the examples of Saints Peter and Paul inspire us to stand up for our faith and to preach the good news to all, we pray to the Lord. That God may hear the prayers in our hearts and those in our intentions book, we pray to the Lord.
Almighty God, without you we can do nothing, but with you the church stands strong upon Peter. And so hear us now, for we make our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Filming the TV Mass takes a lot of people to come together to make it possible. We're especially thankful to those who contribute financially and with their prayers. And so please pray for the following. pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. We bring offerings to your altar, O Lord, as we glory in the solemn feast of the blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, so that the more we doubt our own merits, the more we may rejoice that we are to be saved by your loving kindness. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For by your providence, the blessed apostles Peter and Paul bring us joy. Peter, foremost in confessing the faith, Paul, its outstanding preacher. Peter, who established the early church from the remnant of Israel. Paul, master and teacher of the Gentiles that you call. And so each in a different way gathered together the one family of Christ and revered together throughout the world. They share one martyr's crown. And therefore, with the angels and saints, we praise you, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and you make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and martyrs, with Saints Peter and Saint Paul, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, for those of you who cannot be with us today, we invite you to ask the Lord to come into your heart and to receive him spiritually. And for those that you will see through the lens here receiving Holy Communion from a minister, from a priest, just ask that you would pray for them too, that the Lord would be their strength as well, that they may love God and love their neighbor. Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, who have been renewed by this sacrament, so to live in the church that, persevering in the breaking of the bread and the teaching of the apostles, we may be one heart and one soul, made steadfast in your love. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Bow down for the blessing. May Almighty God bless you, for he has made you steadfast in St. Peter's saving confession, and through it has set you on solid rock of the church's faith. You say amen.
Amen.
And having instructed you by the tireless preaching of St. Paul, may God teach you constantly by his example to win brothers and sisters for Christ. So that by the keys of St. Peter and the words of St. Paul, and by the support of their intercession, God may bring us happily to that homeland that Peter attained on a cross, and Paul by the blade of a sword. Amen. And may Almighty God bless you all, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth and announce the gospel.
Thank you.
These are the saints and feast days that we celebrate this week. On Tuesday, we'll be celebrating Blessed Junipero Serra. If you're from Kentucky, you'll probably say it Junipero. And Blessed Junipero was from Spain in the 18th century. And his witness and work and evangelization in the United States, especially in the state of California, played a significant role in the development of the country. And he's even revered at the Capitol in Washington, D.C., with a beautiful statue marking his contribution to the United States. Then on Thursday, we celebrate the feast day of St. Thomas the Apostle, a significant feast for us as Catholics. St. Thomas, who demanded to see the wounds of Christ, would not believe without having seen them. And as Christ comes and encounters St. Thomas, his doubt gives way to faith, and he has a beautiful profession of faith. And we celebrate St. Thomas the Apostle on Thursday. I want to thank you for staying with us today, and we will look forward to seeing you again next week.
If you're retired and worried about interest rates, did you know that a 75-year-old person can earn a fixed rate of 7.1% on a charitable contribution? It's called a charitable gift annuity, and the money provides the donor with some very generous income tax deductions, and then someday that money will produce an income for your parish, a school, this television ministry, or any ministry that you designate that serves the Catholic Church of Western Kentucky. Call to find out how a charitable gift annuity can assure you a guaranteed high rate of interest while you are alive, and then someday serve the Catholic Church.
Far from major cities and bustling suburbs, there's an invisible Catholic Church in America. A church where parishes are remote and poor. But Catholics, though few in numbers, are rich in spirit, firm in their desire to maintain their faith. Most Catholics know little about this invisible church. It is Mission America.
Most Catholics, when they think of missions, think of foreign missions. The reality is that certain parts of the United States are as much dire need as certain parts of Africa or China.
To receive Extension Magazine free of charge, call 1-888-47-FAITH. That's 1-888-47-FAITH. Or visit us at www.catholicextension.org.